Now let's consider a concept known as non-rivalry in consumption. This sounds rather abstract, but it turns out to be important for a lot of specific issues in the economics of media. Here's one possible way of defining the term. An additional consumer can enjoy the good without infringing upon the enjoyment of others. So take a television program. If someone else captures the signal that's being sent out from the TV tower, well, that doesn't stop me at home from watching the same program. That's an example of non-rivalrous consumption. It's not like an apple. If I eat an apple, you cannot eat the same apple. Sometimes non-rivalrous consumption is a matter of degree. So look around in this movie theater. Could it fit another person? Another 5 people? Yes. But it couldn't fit in, say, another 1,000 people, so it's non-rivalrous up to a particular margin. In a very simple model, if the marginal cost of allowing in extra viewers to the TV program or the movie theater is zero, then perhaps we should set price equal to zero, which would give us a price down here that would correspond to this quantity on the demand curve, and the market would be able to have this much output produced, and all of the available people would get to see the TV show. That's nice, but it's not quite that simple either, because the company still will have some fixed costs of putting on TV shows to begin with, and those fixed costs have to be covered one way or another, and at price equals zero, well, there's no revenue to cover those costs, even if the marginal cost is zero, just getting the station up and running still is relevant. One model is to have a government-owned TV station, as they do in Great Britain, and give the programs away for free with a minimum of advertising, though there is a license fee on those TV sets. Of course, not every country wishes to do this. For one thing, it politicizes TV content. Also, the government station may be less innovative, and in general, it's not a model for how to run all of your TV stations, even if you happen to have one, which is government-owned or funded. To go back to our core picture, what we want for an optimum is to get this much output, the optimum produced, and we've talked about price equals zero, which gives all of the surplus to consumers, but another alternative is price discrimination, where the supplier charges different prices to people at different points along the demand curve, and if perfect price discrimination is possible, again charging these different prices to different individuals, then the entire quantity of output will be sold and we will end up at this optimum quantity. Imagine, for instance, charging higher prices for cable connections in wealthier neighborhoods than in poor neighborhoods, and if you can pull that off just right, again, the producer here is capturing all of the surplus in the market. But if you can't pull it off just right, then for some market buyers, price will be too high, they will be excluded from viewing cable television, even though at a social marginal cost, they could watch those programs without harming anyone, and then again, output is too low relative to an ideal state of affairs. Another way of running a market like this is to fund it partly or wholly through advertising. And in that case, the people who put the ads on television pay the TV stations and help them carry their costs. Consumers then do not have to pay any kind of monetary fee to view the programs, but still there's a kind of deadweight loss from the ads themselves, which are a kind of time price for viewing television. Still, the advertising model in a wide variety of media contexts has proven fairly robust, including radio also. Another way of running markets like this is simply to more or less forget about the notion of trying to include as many customers as possible. So even though on the surface the social marginal cost of including more customers appears to be zero, you could make this argument. You could say, well, let's just let the TV stations charge a higher price. That will exclude some people. But at the higher price, there'll be a greater incentive for innovation. Over time, there will be more diversity of product. Of course, there will be more deadweight loss from the exclusion, but it's at least possible that the gains from innovation will outweigh the costs from that deadweight loss. Note, by the way, that when television is set up this way, for instance, a lot of cable contracts, the way the price is applied, it's applied as a kind of entry fee. It's not that there's a clock ticking and you pay pennies for every moment of Seinfeld you watch. That is, you pay once up front to get access to cable TV at all, and then once you have cable access, at the margin, to view more programs. A lot of them are free, although, of course, for some channels you pay extra for access, such as HBO or Showtime. For more on the economics of entry fees, see our video on two-part tariffs in the How to Think Like an Economist section, and see also material on a la carte pricing, especially for cable TV. What are some lessons for the specific real-world settings where non-rivalrous consumption operates? First, very often we get an imperfect or second-best result rather than something which is optimal. It is ideally possible to include all of the consumers, but practically speaking, that's difficult to pull off. Second, price discrimination often is good. By offering price discounts to individuals who value the good or service less, well, we're including them in output without harming anyone else. Finally, piracy has both good and bad effects. The bad effect is well known. If a customer doesn't pay, that diminishes the incentive for the supplier to produce. But we can see the good effect very clearly in this model. If the social marginal cost of having additional viewers or listeners really is zero, well, piracy is helping bring about some additional consumption of the TV program or the music. Along with fixed costs, non-rivalrous consumption really is one of the key theoretical ideas of media economics. For further reading, you can just Google the term non-rivalrous consumption, but I would also recommend a few of our other videos, including our video on fixed costs in this section, our video on two kinds of natural monopoly in the section on how to think like an economist, our video on price discrimination from that same section. And if you want to learn the more technical economic side of a lot of these questions, you could read up on the economic theory of clubs, and those writings are available online.